Welcome back to the Parkinson's Disease Education Podcast. Now, you may have heard of dyskinesia when it comes to Parkinson's disease, but I bet you never have heard it explained why dyskinesia happens and what causes it to happen in the first place. That's the specific focus of this episode of the podcast. We're going to be first starting with a little bit of a summary of what dyskinesia is, just as a reminder, and then we'll go into the causes of dyskinesia and what can be done about it. Before we go on with the episode, I have one really quick tip I wanted to give you on one of our channel sponsors, which is Comfort Linen. Comfort Linen produces bed linens that includes sheets, pajamas, and more for persons with Parkinson's disease to have ease of movement in bed and the maximum comfort. You can get up to 24% off just by using the link in the description below this episode. And there's an additional 10% sale going on right now on their website. So please don't forget to take advantage of that. That's all I'm going to say about that today. Let's go on with the episode. Without further ado, let's cue the intro in 3, 2, 1, and hit. Welcome to the Parkinson's Disease Education Show, where we demystify the disease and empower you as the person with Parkinson's disease to reach your true potential. The content contained on this show is for informational purposes only and is not meant to be a replacement for information or advice that you receive from your in-person medical or therapy professionals. If you haven't already, I hope you'll consider subscribing. And for an even more personalized experience, please ask us about our memberships. Now, without further ado, let's start the show. So before we dive into the topic of the causes of dyskinesia and Parkinson's disease, I want to take just a moment to let you know about an upcoming webinar that I'm hosting on the channel. It's called 5 Top Parkinson's Myths and How to Debunk Them. That webinar is completely free to attend, and you can find a link to register in the description of this video. It's going to be held on 3 separate dates: the 8th of January, the 15th of January, and the 17th of January. You can look at specifics on the times on the registration page in the description. I really do hope you'll attend that webinar. We have over 8,000 subscribers on our YouTube channel. On Facebook, almost 2,000 followers. I really hope that I can get at least 300 people to attend the webinar. That would be fantastic. And I really look forward to seeing you there. Now let's continue our discussion on dyskinesia. So just as a brief recap of dyskinesia, now in a prior episode, I wanted to let you know I did cover this at more at length, comparing and contrasting dyskinesia and dystonia, and you can find that up here. But in brief, I wanted to at least let you know what dyskinesia looks like and what you might experience if you haven't experienced it or seen it already. Dyskinesia essentially is an uncontrolled movement of either the limb or part of the body. It could be the trunk, it could be the head and neck moving, it could be one arm or one leg or both. It tends to present slightly differently in everybody, but essentially it's fidgety movements, almost like a rhythmic dance-like movement in some cases, or it could just be one limb or one part of the body that's moving. And it's not something that you can stop voluntarily. The movement will happen on a continuous basis. There's 2 types of dyskinesia that are the most common Parkinson's disease, and that's peak dose dyskinesia, where you have the most movements, dyskinetic movements, with your highest doses of levodopa. And there's so-called diphasic dyskinesia, where you'll have the symptoms at the peak dose as well as during wearing off of the levodopa dose. Diphasic is likely less common than the other type, which is peak dose. And that's really what we're going to be focused on primarily. I say we're primarily focused on peak dose because that kind of leads into what our root cause of dyskinesia is. The other name for dyskinesia in Parkinson's is levodopa-induced dyskinesia, or LID. And the reason that it's called that is because dyskinesia, as a movement symptom of Parkinson's disease, tends to result almost entirely from levodopa as a medication. You might have heard that and stopped in your tracks thinking, wait, are you saying that the medication that treats Parkinson's disease actually causes yet another movement disorder? Well, you heard me right. Levodopa unfortunately results in the side effect of dyskinesia. The sad truth is the more levodopa you take over time, the worse the dyskinesia becomes. And I wanted to explain a little bit about why this actually happens and what can be done about it. A relatively recent discovery in exploring the causes of dyskinesia and why levodopa tends to result in this increased dyskinetic movement that then has to be treated by other medications down the road. The unfortunate result of taking levodopa is that there are literally genetic changes that happen to the DNA of the dopamine receptors in the brain. What ends up happening is methyl groups, and for those of you who, it's been a while since you've taken chemistry or biochemistry, a methyl group is simply a carbon attached to three hydrogens, or CH3. Now, methyl groups are a completely normal part of functions in the body, but when genes are abnormally methylated, it can cause problems. Now, in the case of the dopamine receptors, there's an abnormal amount of methylation of those dopamine receptor genes. That, I would theorize, is also part of the reason that you have to take more levodopa over time. It's because the actual dopamine receptors are changing, the very genetics of those dopamine receptors are changing over time. Now, Parkinson's disease in itself, with the reduced dopamine synthesis that happens with those cells in the substantia nigra or the striatum dying off, is that you also have this kind of a domino effect where you also have changes in other neurotransmitter productions and how those behave. So for example, decreased dopamine production also results in decreased production of GABA. We've talked about GABA in previous episodes. It's an inhibitory neurotransmitter, meaning that GABA tends to slow down neurotransmission or nerve signals rather than increase them. So overall, GABA transmission is altered by Parkinson's disease, so that's where you get problems like Parkinson's tremor, for example. As a part of that, though, GABA also can influence things like dyskinesia. So if you have reduced GABA, you can also have increased dyskinesia. The other downstream effect of having these changes in GABA is that you have that you tend to have overactivation of other neurotransmitters like NMDA. Now, NMDA stands for N-methyl-D-aspartate. NMDA as a neurotransmitter tends to be overactivated in persons with Parkinson's disease, especially with these methylation of genes that we talked about in the dopamine receptors. Once NMDA receptors are overactivated, it tends to have a direct impact on how much dyskinesia you experience. So to summarize all that one more time briefly, levodopa tends to result in methylation of the DNA of the dopamine receptors. Over time, you have to take more and more levodopa to have on time or improved symptoms with medication. And therefore, the methylation tends to increase over time to the point where you have this downstream effect where GABA production is affected as well as NMDA production and activation. And that decrease in GABA and increase in NMDA tends to result in the dyskinetic movements that we're talking about. Now, this is the part where I would like to talk a little bit about what can be done about dyskinesia. Now, there are obviously medications that can help with dyskinesia. The most common and the most effective is amantadine, and the long-acting or extended version of that is called GoCovri. Amantadine in and of itself could help with dyskinesia without having an extended release version. The reason amantadine tends to help is because it actually acts as an antagonist or a blocker of those NMDA receptors. So in other words, if you block the receptors of NMDA, that neurotransmitter we mentioned earlier, it blocks the effect of that neurotransmitter. Therefore, it can reduce the dyskinetic movement. So that's great, but how do we prevent dyskinesia in the first place? Ultimately, if you're going to take levodopa, it may not be preventable. However, what I would argue from my perspective is that starting with levodopa as a first line of treatment might not be the best idea. Now, that may be controversial. A lot of neurologists may disagree with my statement. However, I would argue that there is a lot you can do to treat Parkinson's disease, even pharmacologically, without going first to levodopa. One potential possibility is to start with a conservative approach, like just prescribing a monotherapy such as an MAO-B inhibitor to keep the levels of dopamine in the brain higher so that there's more available dopamine to use. So even though you have a decreased amount of dopamine production with the Parkinson's disease, you might also be able to keep those levels a little more stable just with something simple like an MAO-B inhibitor. If that's not enough, you could move forward with a medication like dopamine agonists, which are going to act like dopamine by stimulating those dopamine receptors, but they don't have the effect of methylating the genes of those receptors as levodopa does. The bottom line is just trying to hold levodopa off as a primary treatment as long as possible is likely a solution, or a possible solution at least, to delaying the onset of dyskinesia. If you're an individual with young onset Parkinson's disease, it's extremely likely you're going to experience dyskinesia, especially if you're taking levodopa. That said, pretty much everybody that's 65 plus with Parkinson's is going to develop dyskinesia over time as well. It just may take a little bit longer in those cases. Deep brain stimulation is also another possible treatment solution for dyskinesia. Dystonia and dyskinesia can be greatly improved by DBS. But the problem with DBS is not everybody is a candidate for DBS placement. The primary reason a lot of folks are not a candidate for DBS is that if they have a pre-existing cognitive decline, so if you have some sort of memory issue with Parkinson's disease already and you struggle cognitively, it's highly likely that's going to worsen after DBS placement, and likely they're not going to recommend that. And for that reason, persons with Parkinson's over 70 are often also not recommended for DBS because of that potential of cognitive decline once you have DBS placement. So the bottom line is DBS just isn't available for everybody. So a frontline approach is likely the best idea because, again, if you can manage the symptom of Parkinson's without going to levodopa as the first line response, that's probably going to be the best approach. So the medications we mentioned that could be alternates, I didn't mention COMT inhibitors, that's also a possibility aside from MAOB inhibitors. Although COMT inhibitors you also don't tend to find as a monotherapy. Well, there you have it. Dyskinesia tends to result directly from levodopa. It tends to be from those genetic changes we mentioned that in some form is preventable. So I would just advocate for especially you being a self-advocate and trying to do whatever you can to avoid being on levodopa long-term as long as you can. I'm not saying that levodopa is a bad medication or that it's something you should avoid at all costs. It's definitely something that could be put off for a while as long as your symptoms are being managed by other means. Here on the podcast, we've also talked about a lot of other lifestyle changes that can and should be made with Parkinson's, such as dietary changes, increased exercise, making sure your sleep habits are healthy, and much more. All of that's going to go a long way in preventing rapid progression of Parkinson's, and hence slowing down progression of or development of something like dyskinesia. I certainly hope this episode was impactful and helpful for you. A lot of people wanted to hear about this topic, and so that's why I chose this over others first. Let me know in the comments below what your experience is with dyskinesia and what you're doing to help it. Please don't forget to support our channel sponsors with their links in the description and on the channel main page. Every little bit goes into helping to produce content just like this. Thanks so much for being here. Look forward to seeing you in the next episode. As always, be empowered.